Good morning, church family. Good morning. It's so wonderful to see all of your beautiful, smiling faces today. It is a beautiful Sabbath. Amen? Yeah. Amen. All right. Well, let's begin. We're going to sing our opening hymn, To God Be the Glory, hymn number 341. Would you please stand and join us as we sing?
Almighty Father in heaven, indeed today we come before you to give glory to you, to honor your name. We thank you, Lord, that we know you and that you can help us to know you better. Bless our worship, Lord, may it be acceptable in your sight. For we pray this in Jesus' name, your one and only Son, our Savior. Amen. You may be seated. Would like to welcome you to worship here today at the Piedmont Park Seventh-day Adventist Church. It is a beautiful day today outside, but I am so glad that you have chosen to be inside today as we praise God together. And as we do this, may you be drawn closer to your Savior, your King, and your best friend.
Thank you. morning. Happy Sabbath. I'm so glad for the break in the weather. Probably you are too. I'm tired of 100 degree heat. Even though it is summer, I'd like it to cool down, so I am enjoying these next few days. If you look in the bulletin, you will see that we are behind. And part of that is because people are traveling because it's summer. But school is coming, and they'll all be back. I'd like to get caught up by the end of September. So if you would help us by remembering to contribute to church budget now, when the other people come back, hopefully they will too, and we'll get caught up and be where we're supposed to be. I thank you for each one of you that can help. Will you bow your heads, please? Dear Lord, thank you for the Sabbath day. Thank you for the rain, for the overcast sky, the green grass, and the cooler weather. Help us to remember all the blessings that we have and return those blessings to you and to help our church thrive. We ask these things in thy name. Amen.
As the kids head back to their seats, just want to do a few announcements for you. Of course, you can read everything in your bulletin, and I encourage you to do that. But a few things that I'd like to highlight for you. First off, hopefully you realize that the Lancaster County Fair is happening, and we have a presence there at the fair this year. We are joining together with churches from other parts of Lincoln here, the Adventist churches, and we have a booth there for blood pressure testing and giving away literature. If you would like to help with that, I want you to meet in the foyer after service today with Rich Jacobs. He will be there, and even if you've signed up already, he'd like to talk with you and get things planned out. It's just a great way to connect with our neighbors and share with them a little bit more about our friend Jesus. So meet in the foyer after service today, and they will connect with you. Coming up tomorrow, right here, Adventure Club, Eager Beavers, and was left out of the bulletin, but we're also including Pathfinder registration is happening tomorrow here at the church from 3 till 4 o'clock. It's also an ice cream social. So boys and girls, come and eat some ice cream and then get signed up for a fun year of clubs with Adventure Club, Eager Beavers, and Pathfinders. That's tomorrow at 3 o'clock. There's somebody who's excited already for it. Just a few more announcements today. We have a special one. I've got some folks, some friends that I want to introduce to you that we are doing their transfers in today, and that is Dustin and Christine. Would you guys come and join me up here so we can vote you in? And then I also believe we have the Slys, Randy and Cindy, and I know I saw them earlier. There they are. Come and join me up here, guys. We are just thrilled. These two fine couples have been here with us for several months now, and they have decided that they would like Piedmont Park to be their home. Can you say amen, church? We are thrilled by that. They're already getting involved. You've seen Dustin playing piano and violin today. These guys are also teaching in Sabbath school, and we're just thrilled to have these wonderful people here with us. Is there a motion to accept? I see a hand there, and I'm going to take that one as a second. Now, guys, take a good long look. Everybody in favor, raise those hands for me. Let's see them. Wonderful, wonderful. Anyone opposed? Of course not. And you'll notice I didn't vote against either, even though Dustin is a Red Sox fan. So we had great deliberations about whether or not we could allow him in, but we have decided that the gospel is big enough that we can allow that. So we are thrilled to have you guys here with us. God bless you. Thank you so much. Yes, thank you. God bless, guys. Amen. Just a few more announcements as we get going. Coming up this Friday, we're going to have a Vespers here at Piedmont. Very special Vespers. Pastor Caleb is going to be leading out. So this coming Friday at 7 o'clock, great way to get started on your Sabbath is to come together and worship. So we'd like to invite you to come, invite your friends, your neighbors, anyone you can bring. It'll be a very special service this coming Friday. And since we're talking, one more, I almost forgot. Soup suppers are going to get started up here the first Saturday in September. So Tammy and Daryl wanted me to remind you of that. It's a fun time. Saturday nights we get together for some fellowship, some fun, some food. So I hope you'll mark that on your calendars, the first Saturday night of each month. And what happened to our birthday boy? Pastor Caleb, are you in the back there waiting to come out and sing? Why don't you come and join me out here for just a second? He didn't know I was going to do this today. So he's a little shy, is he? There he is. Yes. Hello, Pastor. You thought you were done after children's story, didn't you? Not quite. Not quite. Well, this is a special day today because it is Sabbath, but also a very special day for the White household. And so I just wanted to take this opportunity to tell Pastor Caleb and all of you a little bit about our journey that brought Pastor Caleb with us. And we are thrilled to have him here with us. Amen. And one of the things we were working on, Pastor Caleb, is we were looking for an associate pastor. We do so many narratives. We do so many things where we have people dressed up in costume, you know, from Live Nativity to Vacation Bible School. And they said, Pastor, what if we decide to do a story about Samson or Absalom, someone with long flowing locks? We may need to find someone who has that capability. So we looked high and low until we find someone who would be able to fulfill that part of sharing the gospel. And Pastor Caleb, there was something else they said as we're searching for an associate pastor. You see, these last 6 years, these wonderful folks from Nebraska have simply fallen in love with my Iowa accent. They have. And they enjoy it so much. And then it took them a while, but eventually they were able to enjoy Pastor Andy's English accent as well. And so they said, if we have someone here, we need someone who, when they preach, they've got that great preaching voice. And so we looked for that too, someone who could share with just a powerful preaching voice that you would never forget. And so we looked high and low, and we found someone who...
And the Lord said, let there be light, and then boom, light. And then he separated the feminines.
And what else did he do, Caleb?
The Lord God made man in his image. He made him male and female. Yeah.
And so we found someone who had that amazing preaching voice that we would never forget. We haven't heard that sermon yet, though, Pastor Caleb. I'm assuming that one is still to come. But we want you to know that you are loved here, and we want to wish you happy birthday. Here he is from just a couple years ago. And Pastor Caleb, in case in the future you ever get the notion that maybe you should turn this back upon anyone else here in the congregation, just remember that this was all Ava's idea, okay? So God bless you. Happy birthday, brother. We are thrilled to have you. If you get a chance, give him a hug, give him a high five, give him a fist pump. Embarrass him if you can. I know he will enjoy that. It's now time to begin our worship, our praise of God. So I'd invite you to stand as we sing together praises to our God and King.
All right. We're going to sing Shine, Jesus, Shine.
Shine on me.
Next hymn is going to be Shout to the Lord. Prayer chorus is going to be, I love you, Lord. And at the end of the prayer chorus, will you please kneel with us in prayer?
The Lord your God in your midst, the mighty one, will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you with a love that is beyond compare, and he will rejoice over you with singing. Dear Lord, we thank you for this promise that is found in your word this morning. We know that for us, your children, your final word is not of anger, as it will be with the unbelievers. but of love, as is expressed in this beautiful verse. And so, Lord, after we have been chastened and disciplined and tested, we know that you will save us and that we can rest in your care and love with rejoicing. We thank you for the promises in your holy word. And now, dear Lord, we thank you for this beautiful Sabbath day that you have given to us. We thank you for your help through the week, for your protection, your mercy, the presence of your holy angels. And we thank you for bringing us here safely this morning to hear your word. Dear Lord, we look at the bulletin, the prayer requests that are mentioned. There are many people that have health issues. We pray for each one of them. Your will be done, that your healing hand will touch each one. And there are a few others that are not mentioned in the bulletin that we want to bring to your attention. We want to pray for Russ and Rachel Huggins. We understand that their baby wants to come real soon, and that's not good. And so we pray that you will keep your hand upon this couple and bless them, that everything will work together for good. We also want to remember Larry Booker, who's having health issues. We pray that you will bless him. Be with each one of us this morning, dear Lord. You know our needs. We put our lives into your hands. Bless the pastor as he brings to us the bread of life. Open our hearts to receive the message and forgive us from sin. Save us, Lord Jesus, so we can go home with you when you come. We pray these things in your holy name. Amen.
New King James Version. When he had called the people to himself with his disciples also, he said to them, "Whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it."
Thank you, Betty, for bringing us the Lord's word this morning, and thank you to each and every person who has helped with our service today. You want me to do what? I stared intently at my wife, and I saw in her eyes she wasn't joking. She was smiling at me, but she was serious. So I shook my head. No way. I can't do that. Have you ever been given a difficult task by someone that you loved? Has that ever happened to you? Ever been asked to do something that was so incredibly hard that you wanted to say no, but the person who asked you, you loved? And so you didn't want to say no at the same time. That was the conflict that was swirling around my head right at that moment. What do I do? I hated to say no, but there was no way that I could say yes. See, many of you know our story. Years ago, Jeanette and I struggled having children. It didn't happen easily. We struggled with miscarriages time and time again until, by a miracle of God, Ethan came along and joined our lives. He absolutely loves it when I show pictures like this of him. After Ethan came along, that time we thought, okay, all right, we don't know what was going on before, but everything has worked itself out. We are good to go. So after a little while, we tried to have a second child. But month after month after month, no pregnancy came. So we prayed. We prayed to God with everything that we had. when there were no answers. And finally, after more than a year, finally there was success and we became pregnant. But we waited to tell people. We were a little nervous. We wanted to wait past that three-month kind of tricky period. We made it past that three-month finally. We said, yes, this is it. And so we made it to the fourth month, and we were going in to see the doctor. We were so thrilled. It was a beautiful July day, and we were going in to find out the sex of our second child. And we went to the doctor, and instead of finding out the sex of our baby, we learned that our baby had died. We were devastated. Eventually, we healed with the Lord's help, and we started trying again to have another baby. And the doctors couldn't tell us why. They couldn't say what was going wrong, but no pregnancy came. So finally, our desperation led us to try infertility help, because we were desperate for a baby. And this led to Jeanette having to take medicine, and she actually had to get needles and shots, and she would give herself a shot in the stomach. And she did that to herself for several weeks, a few months. But that didn't work. So we went back to the doctor. We said, what do we do now? And he said, well, we can take it up a notch. We can do a different shot and a different medicine. And that's what led to this conversation, to this statement from my wife. Michael, you'll have to give me the shots. What, are you crazy? I said. But I can't. Michael, you have to. I'm the pastor. You're the nurse. I told her just in case she forgot. I do theology, you handle the medical stuff. I said, why would, I was scared. Why can't you do it? You gave yourself the other shots. I know, she explained, calm as can be, but this shot can't go into my stomach. Where does it have to go? I asked in horror, knowing that no matter where she said, it wasn't going to help. I still couldn't do it. Now, just to clarify, I'm not afraid of shots. I'm actually not. I grew up with allergies, so I got allergy shots every week in my arm. I'm not afraid of getting shots. Bring it on. But giving a shot to someone that I love? You see, Pastor Caleb, I have a pastor's heart, a soft, caring pastor's heart. I don't have the hard, callous nurse's heart that some people do. No? I mean, my wife, she gives shots to little kids all day long. Oh, I couldn't do it. Where does it have to go? She said, Michael, it has to go in my rump, my backside. I said, well, you can do that yourself. She said, no, Michael, I can't bend that way, and the needle's too big. It has to be you. But wait. I mean, I was desperate. I said, what if I just hold the needle and you back up into it? Would that work? It's not easy being asked to do an impossible task by someone that you love. And yet that's exactly what we find Jesus doing in the Bible. So this morning, let's open our Bibles and let's see what impossible task Jesus Christ tells us, you and me, to do. If you'd open your Bibles to our scripture reading today, turn to Mark chapter 8. It's good to have it in front of you, so open your Bibles if they open, turn them on if they turn on, or you can read along on the screen as well. Let's see what Jesus says to the disciples a long time ago, and let's try to understand what it means. Jesus says to the disciples and to his followers in Mark chapter 8, starting in verse 34, he says, whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself, let him take up his cross and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. Whatever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. Did the disciples like the idea of taking up a cross? Did they like that thought? Of course not. Now you have to remember, when you read these stories, to put yourself in their shoes 2,000 years ago. You see, you and I, we know the cross as a symbol of victory. For the last 2,000 years, that's what we've acquainted it with. But what was the cross to them in their day-to-day life? When they heard about the cross, what did they think of? Not what you and I think of. All they heard was an instrument of torture. Take up your instrument of torture and follow me. The most shameful death, that's what the cross was. And a person who was going to be crucified had to submit to actually carry their own cross to where they were going to die. So the disciples were stunned to hear Jesus say this. To be my disciple, you have to take up your cross. And they didn't like the idea of Jesus suffering either. Look with me, go back to verse 31 now. This is right after Peter has declared that Jesus is the Christ, that he's the Messiah. In verse 31 it says, "And Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things, be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again." As soon as Peter declares that Jesus is Christ, Jesus says, "I'm going to be rejected. I am going to be killed." Immediately, Jesus starts talking about his death on the cross. And Peter and the others reject that idea. Look at verse 32. "He spoke this word openly. Then Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him." Takes Jesus aside and says, "Whoa, whoa, whoa, Jesus, you're wrong." Do you imagine saying that to Jesus? Maybe you've said that before to him. "You're wrong. No, this is not going to happen." Peter and the others just rejected this idea. This idea of the cross and Christ's suffering, they were a problem for the disciples. Why? Because students are supposed to follow their masters, right? And especially back then, if you were following a rabbi, what he does, you are supposed to do. What happens to him is supposed to happen to you if you're a disciple. Students are supposed to do what their master does. Go to the cross? They didn't want to do that. Is Jesus your master? Are you willing to follow him? See, the tricky part of discipleship in the Bible is it involves a cross. A disciple's path in the Bible, always with Jesus, includes the cross. Amen? But many times we say, sure, well, of course, it includes Jesus and his cross. But Mark 8, verse 34, Jesus tells us discipleship involves our cross, too. So as we think about discipleship and following Jesus, what does this phrase, take up the cross, mean? What does it really mean? Have you ever heard people say, well, that's just my cross to bear? Have you heard that phrase before? Raise your hand. Let's see if anybody's said, oh, that's my cross to bear. What do we mean when we say that? A lot of times we're maybe talking about somebody at work who really annoys us. Right? Oh, he's just my cross to bear. Or a situation, that's my cross to bear. Is that what Jesus is talking about? Putting up with difficult people? Friends, it's far more than that. Many in Christianity have not fully grasped the extent of what Jesus meant when he said, take up your cross and follow me. Because many have interpreted that statement as meaning, well, what we got to do is we just need to deny ourselves things in life. How a lot of times we've interpreted it. Just deny myself things. This is why so many people through the centuries have chosen to become monks. I'm going to deny myself food. I'm going to deny myself good clothes or a family, even deny myself of money. And that's what it means to take up my cross. But my friends, Jesus is not so much focused on you denying things. Taking up the cross has a deeper meaning. Because taking up the cross and following Jesus is not about denying things in life, it's about denying self. And there's a difference. And people in the Bible times, when they took up their cross, when they carried it, that was their last act. Life is over if you're carrying the cross back in Jesus' day. They were walking to their execution. And I know, folks, this sounds repulsive, but this is the context that the disciples first heard this statement in, and we have to understand it that way. Taking up the cross to follow Jesus means an end to life as you know it. That's what it means to take up the cross. Following Jesus, being a disciple, is not about just denying yourself things. It means to resign control of our lives in order to receive a better life. Amen? So what is this? What is this true life with Jesus? Let's find out. If you've got your Bibles open still, you can turn to Mark chapter 9, verse 33. We find the disciples and Jesus walking along, and as they're walking, the disciples who've been told in the previous chapter to take up their cross and follow him, what are they doing now as they're strolling along with Jesus? They're arguing. Arguing over who's going to be the best in the kingdom. That was kind of their hobby back then. They did that a lot. Verse 33 of Mark chapter 9. When he had come to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What was it you disputed among yourselves on the road?" He said, "What are you talking about, guys?" But they kept silent, for on the road they had disputed among themselves who would be the greatest. Do they understand Jesus' comments about taking up the cross? Not at all. They missed it completely. Then in verse 35, and he sat down and he called the 12, and he said to them, "If anyone desires to be first, he shall be last of all and servant of all." Taking up the cross, being a disciple, means letting go of control of our lives in order to receive the true life in Jesus. And what is that true life with Jesus? Jesus tells us, true life, if you really want to live, it's about laying aside self and learning how to serve. That's what true life is for the follower of Christ. Following Christ always involves the cross, and it always leads to a true life of service. So let's ask ourselves, as Christians, as churchgoers today, when we come to church, are we coming to be served, or do we come to serve? As we live our day-to-day life, are we looking for the world out there to just serve us, or are we going out into the world to be servants of God? It's a very famous phrase we said years ago, and it still rings true today. As we live our life, we ask, what would Jesus do? It's a good barometer and a good test. You see, so many people struggle with the Christian walk of discipleship because we've presented an incomplete view. Or people think, if I just deny myself of enough things, then my life will be blessed, right? That's not how it works. And that thinking means many people are getting messed up when the hard times come in their life, when suffering comes. And they think, but wait, I was denying myself. I stopped this. I'm not doing that. Why am I having a hard time? Why am I suffering? If you want to write it down or you want to record it in your brain, Jesus' life in the Bible shows us that suffering comes before glory. Suffering always comes before glory. The story of the cross in Mark's gospel, it's a unique story from the others because it exposes the disciples. Who were the disciples on that fateful Friday of the cross? If you got your Bible still open, turn to Mark chapter 14. Mark chapter 14 and verse 50. These guys who had followed Jesus for so long, the arrest comes on Thursday night. In a very short but meaningful verse in the Bible, Mark 14 verse 50. Speaking of the disciples, it says, then they all forsook him and fled. The disciples ran away from the cross. Now Simon Peter, just a little while before, in Mark chapter 14, verse 29, he is bragging about never leaving. Simon Peter says, boy, Jesus, maybe everybody else will leave. Maybe all these other cats will run away, but not me. No way, I'm going to stay till the end. I will never run away. And then Simon carries Jesus' cross. But it's the wrong Simon in Mark. Mark chapter 15, verse 21. And Jesus can no longer carry the cross anymore. Chapter 15, verse 21 says, then they compelled a certain man, Simon, a Cyrenian, the father of Alexander and Rufus, as he was coming out of the country and passing by, to bear his cross. Simon of Cyrene takes up Jesus' cross. But where is Simon Peter? Where's Jesus' close friend? Who was the true disciple on that Friday? And that phrase there in verse 21, to bear up his cross, that's the exact same phrase that Jesus used when he talked to the disciples about taking up their cross. Same phrase in the Greek. Who were the disciples on Friday? Watch this now in Mark chapter 10, verse 37. James and John, the sons of thunder, come to him, and they said to him, grant us that we may sit one on your right hand, and the other on your left, in your glory. And that's what they ask him. But friends, remember what we said? Suffering comes before glory. Who sits on Jesus' left and right on that dreadful Friday? Not James and John, but two thieves. Where are James and John? In Mark chapter 8, verse 29, Peter declares, it's the first time, it's a pivotal verse there in Mark. He said to them, but who do you say that I am? Jesus says, who do you say that I am? And Peter answered, said to him, you are the Christ. You are the Christ. But that was said, Peter declared that in private. But surely Peter would say that on Friday too, wouldn't he? Well, he gets three chances, doesn't he, to declare who Jesus is. Peter, Jesus' friend, the lead disciple, surely he's going to tell everyone, even on Friday, even at Calvary, who Jesus is, right? But the 12 disciples are absent in Mark's version of the cross. But there is someone who does declare who Jesus is on that Friday. Mark chapter 15, verse 39. There is someone who says, this is the Son of God. It's not Simon Peter, it's not James, it's not John, it's a Roman centurion. Who are the disciples on Friday? Who are the disciples at Calvary? And what about us? Will we only be Jesus' followers in the easy time? Or will we take up our cross, deny self, and follow Jesus, even on the Fridays of our lives? Will we accept that to follow Jesus may include suffering? Because suffering of the cross came before the glory of the resurrection. And maybe this morning you're thinking, but why would I do this? Why would I take up the cross? Are you willing to do that today? Or maybe you're thinking, why would I choose to be a disciple? Well, Jesus gives us the answer in Mark chapter 10, verse 29, where he says to you and me, and assuredly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or father or mother or wife or children's or lands for my sake and the gospel's, who shall not receive 100-fold now in this time, houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. Friends, the rewards of taking up your cross and following Jesus are immeasurable. Just a few of them to tell you that Jesus and the Bible tell you about. When you take up your cross, what does it bring you? The fruit of the Spirit will be given to you. That new character, that new heart, way of living, the gifts of the Spirit, gifts in order for you to do ministry, to help someone else know Jesus, that will be yours. Jesus says when you take up your cross, you will have a deeper walk with him, one that you've never known before. You will have that true life what it means to live a life of service. And Jesus says here in Mark that you will receive a future reward. Is that reward worth it? Is this true life with Jesus? Is it worth living, even if it means taking up a cross? Because sometimes in life we suffer for a future reward. I had put it off as long as I could. I didn't want to do it. But Jeanette stood in front of me, holding out the needle, the shot. And she said, "We need to do this to get pregnant. Are you sure you don't like my idea of me just holding it and you backing up? We could still try that." And Jeanette said, "Michael, you can do this. Just pinch the skin and quick, just like a dart." So I said, "Okay, I can do this. I can do this." I clenched my eyes and I think I screamed. I said, "Ah!" And I stabbed the needle into my wife. Then I opened up one eye and I said, "Hey, I did it." And Jeanette looked down and she said, "Yes. Now, if you wouldn't mind, would you put the medicine in and push it in?" I said, "Oh, yeah, sorry about that. That's kind of important." So I pushed the medicine in, I pulled it out, and blood started squirting out everywhere. And I screamed, "Blood! There's blood! I'm sorry, what have I done?" Calm as can be, Jeanette said, "Just bring me a tissue." And so I ran around looking, and I found a tissue, and I ran it over to her, gave it to her, and she applied some pressure. And she said, "Michael, it's okay. That happens. I'm fine." I sat on the floor, breathing heavy, sweat all over me. And I looked up at her and I said, "You can get pregnant from just one shot, right? We don't have to do this again, do we?" She said, "Michael, we have to do it daily." But I got pretty good at giving shots, in case anybody wants one after the service. We did it, because it wasn't about me. I had to deny myself and my desires for something better and a future reward. And we did become pregnant. After all those prayers, after all that effort, we praised the Lord. But remember what we learned? That suffering comes before glory. We had another miscarriage. And we didn't understand. We didn't know what God was doing. So we gave up our dream of getting pregnant again. But we didn't give up our dream of having another child. And once we gave up our plan and began to trust God that He would work it out, He brought to us a wonderful, glorious reward when we stood in the room and we watched Johanna enter the world and enter our lives. Became a part of our family. Why should we take up our crosses? Why should we be a disciple of Jesus? Well, friends, it will lead to suffering. It will include a cross. But the suffering is so worth it when we finally reach the glory of God's plan. Today, my friends, will you choose to be a disciple of Jesus? For a better life here and now, for a life of service, and for the incredible glory, the incredible reward of glory that will be yours in the future. Because my friends, Jesus is still looking. He's still calling. Take up the cross and follow me. Let us pray. Almighty Father in heaven, Lord Jesus, blessed Spirit, we thank you that you're still looking for disciples. And Lord, you're not looking for disciples who will just stand with you when everything's going right and everything's easy. but you're looking for disciples who will still stand with you on Friday when everything seems to be falling apart. So Lord, in our hearts right now, we open them up to you. You know what scares us. You know what holds us back from that complete walk, from picking up that cross. And you know, Lord, that inside each and every one of us right here, right now, we do not have the capability to do it. So Lord, we don't ask for your help, because asking for your help means that we do part of it. We just ask you to change our hearts, Lord, to give us new hearts so that we will want to take up our cross and follow you wherever you lead. Lord, we want that in our hearts so that someday we will have that future glory with you, and so that today we'll have true life with you right here and right now. We ask for that heart, Lord, and we claim the promise that you have heard us and you will be the miracle-working God that you've always been. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we sing our closing song of dedication, I invite you to stand as we sing, Lord, I Want to Be a Christian. And I pray that it's not just a song in your voice, but the song of your heart today. Our Heavenly Father, you have heard the words that we've sung. We want to be like your Son, Jesus. But try as we might, we try and we try and we try, and we can't do it. We can't be like Jesus in our hearts. Lord, we praise you this morning because you are the great physician, and you excel at doing heart transplants. So this morning we ask you for that. Take out our stony heart and give us a heart of flesh, one that will be like you, so that we can pick up our cross and follow you all the way until that glorious day, Lord, when you come again and we hear you say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. And all those who are willing to take up their cross this morning said, amen. Amen. In Jesus' name, God bless each and every one of you. Have a wonderful Sabbath and a blessed week.